a self-made wealthy Jewish fella who always dreamed of owning a huge ranch finally buys himself one in Texas on 60,000 acres. His wife had passed recently from a terrible illness, and he decided to get away from it all and live out his dream, spending his days on this enormous ranch in Texas. He arrives, and it's the biggest damn house he's ever seen, situated in the middle of this gigantic expansion of land, 60,000 acres, and his new home is right in the middle. His first morning, he's sitting out on the porch, surveying all that is his after all these years, and all he sees is land. As far as his eye can see, it's his, it's all his. And way off in the distance is a little puff of what appears to be smoke, but it's moving, this strange puff of smoke. It seems to be coming near him, but it is miles away. It's getting closer, oh my. What is the hell with this little puff of smoke? Eventually, the little puff of smoke becomes what appears to be a car. It's headed his way. It's an old car. It's a truck. Oh, my. It's an old pickup truck, and it's getting closer. It stops at the end of his long, expansive driveway, maybe half a mile. He sees a little tiny figure from this distance getting out of the truck and walking towards him. Oh, my. This is interesting. My first visitor. He's very excited, but he's staying in his chair, his rocking chair on the porch. Finally, the gentleman approaches. He's dressed up in typical Western wear, and he says, "Howdy, partner. I'm your neighbor. Welcome to town. It's great to see you. I hope you enjoy your life here. I sure have enjoyed mine. It's a beautiful part of God's country. Listen, my name is Zeke, and as a welcome, I've decided to throw a party on your behalf. Welcome to the area. And it's tonight. I hope it's not too bad of last-minute notice, but I got so excited I decided to throw this wing-ding together. It's going to be amazing. There's going to be music. There's going to be food. Oh, my goodness, you're going to be so happy. There's going to be singing and dancing and lovemaking. It's going to be fantastic." And the Jewish fellow looks at him and says, "Well, thank you. That's unbelievably considerate of you. It sounds fantastic. What time is this?" "Oh, it'll be about 8 o'clock. "Oh, I see, 8 o'clock. Well, that's a good time for me. And to say, just so I know, how many, what size of an affair are we talking about? How many people?" And Zeke says, "It's just going to be the two of us."
I always second guess at the end of telling a joke to have, why did I clean that up? It's funnier when I say fighting and fucking. Here's a couple of things. Thanks to Jeremy Shelton for that beautiful opening, as always. Brian Tyler for a theme song that I dance to when I'm alone. And, of course, Jeremy R. Scott, who put up our lovely site there and designed all that swinging animation. This is our first morning show. Hi, how are you? We're doing our show live, 11 a.m. Pacific Daylight Time. I got, when I announced this on the Twitter there, a couple of the UK viewers, United Kingdom. Your computer wasn't buffering. Okay. A couple of folks from the UK wrote me and said, 11 a.m. is great. That's 7 p.m. for us. We couldn't be happier. So that's why we're going to do it from now on, 11 a.m. Nope. So anyways, my crew had to be here ridiculously early, one of which had a 10-year high school reunion last night. To suggest that Dr. Chan is hungover would be polite.
That's typical Sunday for Kenny.
Jamie, reflect a little bit on what you mean by that.
Because Kenny, isn't it true that one of your only days off is Saturday? Or it is your only day off?
Yes.
Saturday and like Monday?
Uh-huh.
Yes. So what else is he going to drink?
What else is he going to do but drink?
Yeah, he's got to drink.
Yeah.
So, you know, we accept it. I try to have pizza for him.
10-year high school reunion. Boy, there's really only one way to enjoy that event. You can answer the following question well. So what are you up to? You've really got to have a fantastic answer when that is asked of you 472 times. So what's up with you? I'm an international film star. Your turn. Anyways.
Oh, really? What have I seen you in?
Yeah, exactly. Then the high school person says, really? What have I seen you in? All right, so it's early here, and we're all just fine. There's coffee. Don't worry about us. Will we do the show again at 11 a.m. anytime soon? I'm going to go off and do a big press day for Middlemen, this wonderful motion picture that George Gallo wrote and directed. A friend of our guest today. We'll talk about George Gallo. This wonderful film with Luke Wilson, Giovanna Ribisi, and Gabriel Mott, a whole bunch of great people in this movie. Very exciting. Opens up on your August 6th. So today's a big press day. And then I'll come back here afterwards for your ThisWeekend.com shows. The first one, This Week in Comedy, with Ed Krasnick. I'll be his ghost and guest at 6:30. On your Pacific Daylight Time this evening, and then that'll be followed by This Week in Movies You Shouldn't Miss. Ask Kevin is a lovely little segment we do on the show. I'm assuming there's some sort of graphic available when I now say, let's do Ask Kevin.
Ask Kevin.
Life is sweet. All right, these are in fact emails that you write to contact@kevinpollockschatshow.com. asking me your insightful questions, and I attempt to answer them. This one from Bruno Santos, who writes, hi, in my opinion, in the past couple of years, TV shows really regained strength, and I think more creative and interesting shows are starting to appear. It's a slow process, but it seems to be working. My question is, do you think web series had any impact whatsoever on that, being that web series naturally feature more creative and risky roles? Do I think the web had anything to do with the current state of television's quality? That would be swell. That would be fantastic. I do know that a big part of the original content quality of the last few years had a lot to do with the last writer's strike, where many striking writers took it upon themselves to create original content for the interwebs, and that's when it all kicked up to another notch. So did that then inspire some of their work when they returned to television? No question. So yes, somehow the internet content has helped the slightly larger screen. This next question comes to you from Kiosical?
Yeah.
Would be my guess.
Sure.
Kiosical writes, hello, Mr. Pollock. In your role in the movie Another You, is your role in the movie Another You basically what would happen to your mind if the silly voices, as Jamie would lovingly put it, Jamie is never lovingly putting that when she says silly voices, completely took over your mind? Should we be afraid? The silly voices in my head, if they took over, would it be like the role I portrayed in the movie Another You? First of all, there's only 9 of you that have seen Another You, so thank you for being one of those. Do you have meetings and reunions of your own? So sad, actually, that movie. It was the last film Richard Pryor did, and he teamed with Gene Wilder for the last time. And Pryor, the genius, unparalleled genius, was literally dying as we were shooting, and that's what you see on screen, and boy, there's nothing funnier than that. So consequently, the film was painful for most people to watch, but your question had nothing to do with that. I just thought I'd share. If the silly voices took over, well, that's one of the great things about Jamie not lovingly calling them silly voices, because they never really get to breed and breathe often. around the homestead there, because they are immediately deemed as necessary, if not annoying. So, but wait a second, perhaps that feeds into your question. They are thriving inside my cranium as opposed to getting out where they might have a normal life. Yes, the role I played in another you is exactly what's to come. Enjoy. Ask Kevin, very simple, just, is it right? Contacts at kevinpollockschatshow.com?
Yep.
It's fantastic, I got something right for a change. So write your questions to me there and I'd be happy to try to answer them. More of that in the future. Thank you, each and every one of you. You will not win a prize, should I answer your Ask Kevin. However, if you submit a Larry King game, you will, in fact, get a prize if I read your Larry King game live on the air. Don't forget to go to the site, kevinpollockschatshow.com, hit on the door games, and load up your own damn Larry King if you so desire. There's video as well as the opportunity to write us one, which I will now read this week's winner, who's got a Kevin Pollock's Chat Show t-shirt coming their way. Now, this is a Twitter name, at Craig Gorey. Big fan of the Craig Ferguson, I believe. At Craig Gorey, please write us again with your name and address and shirt size so that we may, in fact, send you your prize. At Craig Gorey will offers up this Larry King game. I lost my virginity to Charlotte Ray. Hardscrabble, Delaware. Hello. It's just that simple, ladies and Jews. If you, too, would like a Kevin Pollock's Chat Show t-shirt, just write a Larry King game.
Mrs. Garrett.
Mrs. Garrett. He lost his virginity to Mrs. Garrett.
I hope Tootie and Natalie weren't watching.
Aw. What is Natalie up to?
Natalie?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I read something about Tootie recently.
Oh, what'd you read?
Did not go well for her.
No?
No.
How do you mean?
No, that's the article I was reading. It's like how she, her career kind of went downhill. After
well, that's what happens if you stick around long enough.
Yeah.
And are not fortunate enough to get on your own podcast. Please email your address and size, if you would, to contact at kevinpollockschatshow.com at Craig Gorey so that we can send you your fabulous t-shirt. And now, a word from our sponsors. Mosey.com. Hey, with Mosey, you can be sure your digital life will always be there when you need it. Oh, yes. Online backup service with more than 1 million customers backing up more than 25 petabytes of information. Petabytes is a petabyte, 1,000 terabytes. Live with that. Back up your critical data, protect your personal files. Two different ways. One for your home use. Oh, yes. Stuff like your photos, videos, your musics. Second, of course, for businesses, which include administrative features and 24-hour customer support. 24 hours a day. They're there for you at Mosey.com. Fear not. Set it up once. Don't think about it again. You understand? Move on. You're set up. Unlimited online backup plans start at $4.95 a month. Don't be a cheapskate. Mosey.com. There's some sort of contest, Dr. Chen. 15% off how? What?
Enter Kevin at checkout.
Ah, yes. If you simply enter Kevin as a password or a code, a promotional code, the word Kevin, when you check out, there's a 15% discount. That doesn't seem like a contest to me. By the way, I was told it was in contest form. No. No. Advantage, yes. Contest, not so much. Our second sponsor, of course, the fine folks at PickClick.com. Let me just say this, if I may, about the wonderful people at PickClick. It's really quite simple. You go to PickClick for a couple of reasons. Allow me to explain. It's a visual search engine that helps you shop more effectively.
I understand when you shop, sometimes you're not terribly effective. So browse through photos from your favorite sites to find exactly what you want, but faster. Oh, much faster. How about 12 times faster, knucklehead, than browsing at the actual site itself? It's really that simple, sir. I don't mean to be a pest. It features sites such as eBay, Amazon, Etsy, plenty of fish for dating, Yelp for your food and businesses, and of course, Google. Categories make it easy to zero in on just the content you want. Scrollable allows you to make the image as big or small as you'd like as well. Picklick.com.
Thank you, proud sponsors. And a wonderful job they're doing helping us to feed our crew and put a few ducats in their pockets on the way home. So thanks to all of our sponsors, all of them being Mosey.com and PickClick.com at this point. We're looking still for a sales executive specializing in the entertainment world. For example, on August 15th, we've got your Neil Patrick Harris on. Why shouldn't someone contact NBC and say, hey, you rich bastards, shouldn't you be spending a couple of dollars on the Kevin Pollak's chat show with a one-time sponsorship? What do they spend, $50 million a year? I don't think we're asking much. If you'd like this job, write to contact at kevinpollakschatshow.com. All right. I believe that's all the business for now. After Steve Martin, Richard Pryor, George Carlin, Robert Klein, Martin Mull, Freddie Prinz, and Albert Brooks, and a few others, made stand-up comedy a starring attraction through the mid to late 70s, they were followed by a new generation of comedy greats. As the new decade rang in, such soon-to-be luminaries as Robin Williams, whoa, don't be frightened, David Letterman, Jay Leno, Gary Shandling, Richard Lewis are followed in short succession by the next stars. Jerry Seinfeld, Eddie Murphy, Bill Maher, Roseanne Barr, Stephen Wright, Sam Kinison, Whoopi Goldberg, Paul Reiser, Dana Carvey, just to name a few, and a handful of other true notables such as my guest today. Among those of my generation who did or do stand-up, his name springs to mind myriad of routines and stories from a life in an art form that has shined so kindly on his unique perspective of what makes him and ultimately us laugh. He is a master craftsman who has made quite a name for himself over the last few decades as a splendid character actor as well. Please welcome comedian, actor, author, Harold husband, and doting dad, Larry Miller. Hello, sir.
Hi, pal. Boy, I have to tell you, I don't think it's just vanity.
No?
It's mostly vanity, but I don't think it's just vanity. We're friends anyway, but that was a wonderful introduction and really, really, really very sweet. Thank you.
Oh, my pleasure. I sit down each week to try to pull the dossier together on each guest from the research that our wonderful producer, J-Mac, or at Jason_McIntyre, if you care to follow him on Twitter, it puts together a couple of dozen pages of research from the interwebs, and then I try to hone it into some sort of a dossier. And in doing so, I then decided a couple of months ago after doing the show for over a year, you know, maybe I should spend a little time on the intro instead of just saying, and now here's Knucklehead. And it's been kind of a really fun thing to actually take a little time and offer up a perspective of...
Sure, because as we know, not just in stand-up and acting and everything we do,
yeah,
including this and all the new storytelling we talked about going out there, when you put your personality in there, when you put specifically your head,
right,
your speech pattern, your thoughts into something, it jumps off a screen, any screen.
Yeah.
It jumps off the stage in stand-up. People know in a second in stand-up. Lenny Bruce once said, one of my favorite lines of his, is that of audiences, individually they may be idiots, but together they're a genius, which is to say that,
wow,
they know everything, and they do, as you well know, an audience, the second you walk out, knows if you're lying to them, if you're not happy, if you're insincere.
Right.
That before you even open your mouth, they get it on a wave. And that's if,
yeah,
performers, when they say, hi, it's great to be here, they know if it's not great to be there.
Yes.
They know if you love right. performing. Right. You and I do. They know if you like the audiences. You and I do.
Yeah.
They know if you love this form you're in. You and I do. So they know everything. And then so it's the same thing with introductions. Sure, if you make it personal.
Yeah.
That's one of the reasons. Well, kidding aside, it's not just because it was about me. I thought, wow, that's a really specific, good
thought
introduction.
Out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it matters.
Yeah, I've always marveled how you we have basically 30 seconds, our first 30 seconds, to relax the audience's sphincter. They just want to know they're in good hands.
That's right. It'll all be okay.
Yeah.
And that's why, by the way, there's no such thing every time someone has said, well, what if a new piece doesn't work, or a new bit, or even a new line? Mm. What's the feeling like? And I've said, to the best of my ability, first of all, I don't know you. Second, so you need to stop speaking. But no, I say, to the best of my ability, that, you know, it doesn't matter. That's the wrong question in a way.
Yeah.
If you like being there, it's a fine moment, as long as you're not telling the audience, uh-oh, something didn't work. It always works.
Yeah.
Because you thought of it and you wrote it.
Yeah.
You were there earlier in the hotel room or your office going, you know, well, say, that seems funny. Now, will it stay in? Maybe, maybe not.
Right.
But because you put your humor into it, so it works as long as you don't say, yeah. well, I guess that didn't work. Uh-oh, what do we do now? Then, as you said, they tighten up again. This
yeah. I'm always amazed at the comedians, the variety of choices of what to do with that moment. Dana Carvey, who I started out with in San Francisco in the late 70s, had this ridiculous ability, which I've seen others do horribly, which is to embrace the moment as it's happening by actually talking about it within a nanosecond and not going, well, that didn't work, but rather talking directly to the energy of it not working. I just remember marveling. And then years later, watching other people, you know, if they were new at it, their defenses coming up and actually breaking that leap of faith, which is, what happened? You know, what's wrong? As opposed to, you know, I was always one of those never let them see you sweat guys for very, very long, no matter. And I remember early on, I don't know if you remember Marty Cohen.
Sure.
Yeah, early, he was an early mentor of mine when I was about 20, and he was already doing well in the area, and he saw my act, and I was so anxious to know what he thought. And he said, well, let me just say, when your material catches up to your stage presence, you're going to be a power to reckon with. And it was that essence of let the audience know you know what the hell you're doing first, and then the funnier will come as you evolve and mature and actually have a life to talk about.
Sure. If you don't strain and stress, or I don't, or the people who are supposed to be able to know a little of something about this, the funny part, in a sense, is never, whether it's a script, a play, a movie, a TV show, anything, or stand-up work, the funny part, in a sense, isn't the hard part. Not that anything's hard, but the craft part is, everything else is the beams of the house and the foundation and the roof. And the funny part is the shingles. So once you put all the pipes in and all the wiring, by the way, right there is the only knowledge I have about how to build a house. I don't even know if that was right. Well, you know, I was searching like mad for words like beams and pipes. You know, I have no sense of...
As opposed to when Adam Carolla was here, what you want is you want your K-bolt. You want your K-bolt, you want to hit that with the noggin box.
That's why I like the guy so much. I love doing his show because we couldn't have two humans who are less alike in that way.
Yeah.
When I saw the Clint Eastwood movie, Unforgiven, where the one where Gene Hackman is the sheriff in the town, out of all the great scenes in that movie, out of all the power, the violence, the character study, the most amazing thing to me was whenever they cut to Gene Hackman building his own house and saying he's putting shingles up and one falls off, and I kept thinking, well, how bad can he be as a person if he knows how to put a piece of wood on something? Because I couldn't. I know this sounds like a cultural stereotype, but it's
funny, those human moments when building a character. I remember the movie The Contender, Joan Allen, Jeff Bridges, Gary Oldman. Jeff Bridges played a president. And there's a scene when he's in that one-lane bowling alley that's in somewhere in the bowels of the White House. And Jeff Bridges is talking to, I think, Joan Allen's character. And he's taking off his bowling shoes and putting on his regular shoes. And as he's talking to her, before he puts on his regular shoe, he just smells it for a second before he puts it on. And boy, oh boy, the president just smelled his shoe before he put it on.
That's right.
He couldn't be more human in that exact moment.
That's a great one. That's why when our friend Reiser was in his first movie, Diner, when he saw Barry Levinson, who directed it a few months later, they were talking about one of the scenes in with Mickey Rourke, and Reiser just mentioned, yeah, I remember there was one take that was really good, but then he ruined it by eating the sugar, you know, and exactly, you know, and I know, and everyone out there knows, and Barry said to him, and because Reiser had told me, Barry immediately said, oh no, that's the shot we're using, because it was so spontaneous and it was so character driven, as you just said, as he's talking and as he's thinking, suddenly just picks up the sugar container from the 50s and starts eating it. By the way, that the bowling alley thing in the White House is always, that's one of those things. I have no sense or knowledge of politics either. I have no faith in any city council, or I've gotten too cynical. You know, I have faith in this and that and the things we do and family and God and drinking. I don't know how those all come together, by the way, but they do for me. At any rate, though, but When I first heard about the bowling alley in the White House, just over the years, not even in comedy, it amazed me of, and I don't even know, who was the first guy to say, how about a bowling alley? You know, because it was somewhere, I'm guessing, between Grover Cleveland and Eisenhower, somewhere in that 80-year period.
Right.
What aide or what president said, look, that's all well and good, but what I want is a bowling alley. Just get it done.
And I'd like to think that the president asked for the single-lane bowling alley as a way to get rid of people who were visiting him. I don't want to think of the president actually throwing a couple of...
Or really wanting to. I, in fact, wrote something about... that's right, for the Huffington Post when on that thing came out about smoking. You know, and I wrote a session saying, let the guy smoke, stop it, you know, just... Yeah. Leave him alone. That maybe, in fact, that's the answer. Go down to the bowling alley when the guy from North Korea comes. Never mind those stupid photo sessions they have where they're both in the chairs like that.
Throw a couple frames.
And they pretend to look at each other and smile like that and nod gravely and say, oh, I know what you mean. And instead of that, yeah, go down, take off the suit jackets, put on some bowling shirts.
Please.
You know, have some St. Pauli girl waitress, you know, come with all the mugs of beer. Oh, look at her. Say, hey, it's a healthy kid, you know. And then have a couple of smokes. He's from North Korea, probably smokes. You know what? And then worry about, so do you have to kill everyone in South Korea? You know, then worry about it after a beer. But that bowling alley thing has always made me laugh of, really, a bowling alley? That's also like the thing that...
In case you forgot we were America.
And it's still one of the last public places. A friend of mine was just saying, Alan Zweibel, you know, a great...
Was on this show a month and a half ago.
He's great, one of the greatest comedy people around. And he had pointed out that bowling alleys were one of the last places to gather because we were all separating in a way. And why leave the house? You know, it's like the invention of television times a billion. With all the things we can all do and all the entertainment that we're part of now.
Yeah.
And but it's just fascinating to me that the things that, like a bowling alley, for instance, putting that in the White House. When I was a kid, I used to think an extra phone next to the toilet. Mm. When you go in a hotel,
yes.
I remember, I don't even know why. When I was 10 or 11, I would think, wow, there are hotels where they give you an extra phone next to the toilet, and I really thought that would really be something. An extra phone, then, wow, that's really elegant. Or
and nothing
only
more
the top
elegant
places.
Than talking when you're sitting on the shitter.
That's what I'm getting at, by the way, that when I first saw one, as we began to work on the road and left comedy condos for nicer hotels,
right.
When you first, the second you first see a phone next to the toilet,
that.
You think, well, A, look at that, and then B, this is disgusting. What can't wait 30 seconds? What is possibly either, no, I need to make that reservation. Honey, I'm going to call the restaurant in the lobby now. Right now.
Because that ties together nicely.
Yeah, it's just, or Jim, it's Bob. Listen, on that Higgins merger, I just had a thought. Oh, golly. What did you say? Nothing. Anyway, I think if we cut production... Whoa! Whoa! Wowie! Where are you calling from? I'm on the toilet. Anyway, on the Higgins merge, you're on the toilet? Are you out of your mind? Call me back. No, this is a good idea. Oh, boy. You know what? You're fired. Don't call back ever. What can't wait? And now when I see, it's vestigial. It's still hanging around. Everyone has cell phones. No one even uses hard lines for the most part anyway. Yeah. So seeing a phone next to a toilet now is like seeing a car with a crank on it.
Yeah.
You know, you want to say, what is this goofy thing doing on the wall?
Yeah.
It's not 1961 where the top agent was brought the phone. You see, like in old movies, you know, they had the plug in their hands and they'd say, Mr. LaMotto, call for you or something, and they'd plug it in, and that was, ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah.
They carried the phone over.
Right to the table, right to the booth.
Yeah, now it would look like he was just going to hit you and throw you out.
Yeah.
I just got off on that because I always loved the bowling alley in the White House thing. Really, why a bowling alley?
Let's begin the journey. You were musically inclined at a very young age, and that is not just to say you were forced by your parents and or just mom to sit down in front of the piano and take lessons. Did you actually have your own sort of inclination before the lessons began, or during, or after? Or?
I guess it's all those things. You know, what people, whether it's for us acting, writing, stand-up, and for me it's going to be music again now, and actually bringing performing into a more of a one-man show concept.
Mm, right.
And I've never, my mom used to always say, why don't you play some music in the act? And I never did.
Right.
But when you're a kid, first of all, we think everyone watches TV the same way we did. When we first saw Casablanca on TV or something, it was, of course, transfiguring. You know, it was just so immense. We didn't know. We were already starting to get information in that we would use as performers. But in music, sure, I loved it. I was a music major at school. I had lots of bands in junior high and high school. We played at everything, Sweet 16s, and not very many elegant places. Just, right. You know, kids' parties or something, and we'd get $50. And it was great, though. And I actually made a living when we were getting started in those days. I played drums at the comic strip. Because they hired a drummer for Friday and Saturday night. You get $25 a night.
To play people on or do rim shots?
No. You know what? To play people on, but one of my fondest memories. Did you ever know Ronnie Shakes? He passed away.
Sure.
He was a great, great comic.
One of the all-time
great. Dear, sweet guy. Great line writer. He was more in the form of Rodney Dangerfield or Stephen Wright. And he great, great line writer. And permission and his fun, we used to go, I would go up with him specifically to do rim shots on his jokes because he loved it.
Yeah.
And it was, as you know, in fact, it's really old style comedy. It's so much fun to do. It's like right out of vaudeville.
Yeah.
I mean, the word slapstick is, I think, 1890 or 1904, that when the jokes were told on a stage, and they were like bang jokes anyway. So I said to him, he said to me, I said, bum, bum. And they would slap a stick, you know, like one of those whip crack things. So it was the early way of telling the audience, now.
Yeah.
And then it became a cue that we all have in our head of brum, bum.
Yeah.
It's done with some irony.
Right.
Now that it's saying, it's kind of an eye roller of, oh, you mean that's just a regular joke. But we did it without irony.
Sure.
He would say, he had some beautiful stuff. There's one maybe the only one I remember of him, been saying, he had a sort of a laconic delivery. And he said, been seeing a psychiatrist for 5 years now. And he said something the other day that brought tears to my eyes. He said, no habla inglés. That's a heck of a joke. He was a great writer, a great comic, and always with a smile.
Yeah.
It was great, joyous stuff. So that's the type of line, when you hear that, you could go, and you can get four or five different varieties of, without being too obtrusive, but, you know, and it was a lot of fun. So oddly enough, it was introductions and some rim shots.
Well, when you moved to New York, after graduating from the Amherst, was it?
Yeah.
You moved there to be...
Sounds like a sanitarium when you say it.
Sure.
That way, but
the Amherst.
Which it may, be, like all colleges.
Yeah. But you moved to New York initially to be a professional musician, or no?
No,
How diverse was the dream?
I had no idea what I was doing. I was a music major at school because I just was, because it seemed to make sense. But all I did really was hang out with my friends.
Right.
And in fact, no kidding, I was a music major. It was a small school, 1,200 guys at that point. And the music building had one of those long glass walls that was right across the street from the fraternity I was in. And I had missed my senior year pretty much every class of this composition class I was in. And when I say missed, I mean didn't go. I wasn't the best student
right.
at that point. Now I'm a great scholar.
Mm-hmm.
But I went to see this professor. It was a nice young professor named Ernie May, and he was a composer, and he'd said to me, I was in his office, and he said, I have to be honest, he was very sincere about it. He said, I have to be honest, I'm not even sure why you're here, really, because I had brought him a big stack of things. He said, every time I hold class, I see you across the street on the roof of that building drinking with your friends. And because it never dawned on me, and I'm a music major.
You idiot.
They had two music majors every year. I was one of them. The composition classes were three people.
Oh, my God.
So it was like an Oxford tutorial where it's just the professor and three guys, and, you know, the professor's saying, would you like to stay after class?
Yeah.
But but here this nice man is saying, and he caught me leaning in, and I said, because I was trying to make up for not having gone, and when he said, in that building, and I said, there was another great moment in life. Of two profiles looking at each other,
right.
And about 5 seconds of silence after that. So you're just drinking every time I have the class, but you're leaning in. You can't just lean back and go, well, I don't know what to tell you.
You're leaning in. You're already committed.
And you have to just nod and say, so what can we do
here? Work with me.
I brought some stuff. Should I just leave now and go back to I won't get back on the roof right now, because that would be kind of like a thumb in the eye, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
That would be like a...
Yeah.
It all worked out fine, but the point is, I didn't think about being anything really after college.
Really?
I went back to New York because I grew up on Long Island.
Sure.
And I went back to... I lived at home for 6 months and in the upstairs. My parents were great. They never pushed me. I thought about going to law school, and I thought about anything. And then I thought, well, let me get a job first. And I got a job at Amtrak in New York at a Penn Station on the reservation lines with the thing that comes around. They had the mouthpiece that comes around the number, please. You know, that woman from Abbott and Costello. And after 8 hours, it gets to you. It doesn't, just that those two metal bands across the top, oh boy. But I got that job,
right.
And then I moved into an apartment with some friends from school on the Upper West Side, and just thought, well, then one of the girls, Maureen, that I worked with, said, I heard you were thinking about being a comedian, because I guess I had talked about it. And she said, well, my uncle works at a new club on the East Side called the Comic Strip. And I told him, and he said, well, he was the bartender. That was Tony D'Andrea.
Ah.
Another great impressionist, by the way.
Yeah.
And he was bartending that night. And I just went by at 1 a.m. And he just was nice. He used to play the bells of St. Mary on the wine glasses on the rack. And the owners hated that. But because they, and one reason being, because they would break. He would go, the bells of St. Mary, pa, 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 they're like light bulbs falling. And they were old bar owners from New York just say, Tony, don't do that.
You idiot.
But he was funny. So the point is, then he said, he just took me in the back room, and it was about 1 a.m, and the first comic I saw go on stage at that second, he put me in the back, there were about 8 people still left in the audience. But as you remember, we always went up, you could go up for 2 people.
Yeah.
And you could always get on stage and always learn something. And I sat down there, and the first guy I saw go up on that stage at that moment and wearing a comic strip t-shirt was Seinfeld.
Is that right?
So there's kind of a funny thing. And I thought, wow, he seems funny, And so that's more or less how you just get into something. I had no idea. My parents didn't push me. I was in my own little world. I didn't think, but you don't make anything, and then you make $25 for 6 months later after that, I heard, They were putting a drummer on, and I asked the piano player, Cliff, if I could be the drummer, and he said, okay. And then John McGowan, one of the owners, said to me, I heard you're thinking of quitting your job at Amtrak. Would you like a couple of bartending days and for $25 a piece? And by the way, he put me on nights initially, too. But I've written about this. There's a chapter, and it's all true. And I was a great bartender because I was friendly. I loved it. We're playing roles. You and I are good at roles. You put your foot up on the speed rack, and you can listen to someone. You got the Daily News open. You nod to regulars as they walk in. You wink at the jukebox guy. I had it all down.
You've seen it done in movies.
And I was really good at it.
Right.
With one tiny exception. I can't make drinks. I don't know how. I can do a scotch and soda. How much can you louse up a scotch and soda? Although the amounts were inconsistent. You know, I would sometimes, little ice, sometimes big, and then I would sometimes pour like, and forget and pour it all scotch and just like a little dart of soda, and people would but I couldn't make a Brandy Alexander or a Scarecrow or a Grasshopper, whatever they are.
Right.
And so after, everything became bottles of Bud, when the waitresses would come out and say, oh, hi, Larry, yeah, give me two slow, comfortable screws and two Brandy Alexanders and two this and that's and two Mai Tais, and I would just put six bottles of Bud on their tray.
And they said, but Larry, serve them this.
They said, but Larry, they didn't ask for beer, and I'd say, it's free, just tell them it's free. And so everybody was happy, and I would take... This is such a great story about innocence. I would take money out of whatever I was making, the $25, and I would put essentially all the money I was making money. It was only $25. And I would put that in the till against the beer. I wasn't trying to steal anything. And then John, one night, we were so stupid and innocent, people like us. These were, you know, great, tough old New York bar owners. And John was coming through, and I said to him, listen, John, do me a favor. Some friends from school came in, and I just gave them a bottle of Murphy's Irish Whiskey. I just poured shots for them today, and so I owe you for that. And plus, I've been just taking beers out and making drinks, so maybe you could put another bartender on with me, because I can't make the drinks, but I do everything else great. Now, it's a death offense. It's a capital offense for a bartender to ever leave his post. Reiser would come in doing a new bit, and I'd say, let me see it, and I'd just leave. I would just stand in the back with the waitress and watch. Hey, good, it's a new bit, good bit. And I'd go back out, and people didn't want to have drinks, and I couldn't even make them anyway.
You know, earlier when you said I was a damn good bartender?
Great.
No, not really.
I was fantastic in 9 out of 10 of the ways. Yes. With the one way being, I can't actually make drinks. Right. Now, you may say, you want to be a stickler, Kevin. You might say, well, Larry, that's actually the one thing. Fine, let's not quibble, Kevin. But no, by the way, when I told John all this, I didn't even notice. I swear, I didn't even notice. He was looking at me with like a Sopranos death stare. Because I leave the bar, I can't make drinks, there's no money in the till, I'm actually giving things away for free and saying, I'll go to the store later and get you another bottle because I gave it to my friends. And he told me, we became friends, he told me years later, he said, you know why I never, I said, why did you never got mad at me that night? He just put me on the days and kept me as the drummer. And he just said, no one had ever been that honest with him. He knew I wasn't lying.
Right.
He said, it's a death offense. I mean, no, he said, you didn't even seem embarrassed by it. You thought we were friends or something. And I said, I thought we were. And that same knucklehead suburban kids, gee, I thought we were. And he said, not then we weren't. He said, but since you didn't know, and then you walked away and clapped me on the back and went back behind the bar, he said, I was just shocked and thunderstruck he said, and that's why I didn't take you out to Jersey. And then it hit me later, he didn't live in New Jersey.
Yeah.
And he wasn't kidding.
He had to
go out to Jersey.
He was going
to
put you down.
You'd be on the 40-yard line at Giant Stadium.
Right.
You know, hey, what's that bump?
X is over your eyes.
Just what happened? Yeah. He left the bar. He gave his friends drinks. And every bar owner would go, oh, you got to kill him.
Yeah, that's not an option.
It's like a soldier leaving the post. You're on guard duty. What happened? Well, I was tired, so I went back in. You, what? You can't. It's a war. You have to. Now we're going to shoot you.
Yeah, you're fine with that, aren't you? So you see Seinfeld on stage that first go around, and I suppose it isn't too long after you're the drummer that you're actually on stage trying out sets, and
From the first.
Yeah.
Right from the beginning.
And you and Jerry and Reiser and
Jimmy Brogan, Carol Leifer, Mark Schiff.
Mark
that was
Schiff.
Our little
yeah. Become fast friends because you're similar age, similar backgrounds, and going through a very similar moment in life.
Sure.
Which is those early days.
And Mike Kane, who's passed away now, long, many years. And it was great. It was, what a moment in the universe. I mean, I guess other people have different ways of looking at it, but I just thought, wow, and we're together every day. There was a lot of knuckleheadness, you know, to it, of... We're just friends, and we just come every night, and we're all there all night, and they let you drink for free, and I came during the day to practice piano, and then they'd let you cook during the day. The place was sort of like your clubhouse. Now, you made zero.
Right.
There was no salary for the sets, for the comedy.
Right.
I never really thought too much about that. It was what they used to call showcase clubs in those days, so they didn't really pay anything. A few years in, they started, they'd give you like $5 or $6, and they used to call it cab fare. But that was still fine. You were there 7 nights a week. I was there...
7 nights a week, wow.
10 hours a night, because there wasn't one comic I didn't see every single night until I got on. It starts out, you get on at 3 in the morning. It's New York, so the places are open until 4. And even though there were two old drunks there,
right.
Two guys from out of town, you could still perform. In fact, that was the MC's job, to essentially say, we got 3 more comics, guys. Could you just hang out? Because it means a lot to them to get on stage, and they've been waiting to get on, and you guys are great. So whether they laugh, and you know what? They always stayed.
Wow.
There were other times on the road, both of us have had, when you've had sometimes rude people, or people get drunk and they get mean sometimes, but never those days, and never, oddly enough, you'd think it would happen in New York,
right?
But never, and they always stayed, so we could always get on stage at 3 in the morning, then at 2, then at 1, then at midnight. Then at 11, prime time was like 10:30 or 11 or so.
And how long do you think you guys were doing it before the notion of a profession, of a calling, starts to settle in? Because I imagine there is a sense of camaraderie, and you're young enough so that you don't have to take any of it too seriously.
Right.
You're certainly not being put to task to take it seriously.
Right.
By any sort of administrative individual or,
right.
or entity, and it's so much fun. It's just fun for so long.
Yeah.
That at what point was it a matter of someone asking if you wanted to do a so-called road gig, or what was it? Any sort of turning point that it started to feel like this is going to be my profession.
You know what? For me, I can't speak for some of the other fellows we
right.
know, but I don't think I ever had that thought of a turn. For me, I was just. Suddenly you're ramping in, suddenly you're just doing this, and suddenly you start to make a little money, and then a little more, and the road jobs come up a little more. And then our general way in New York was after 4 years, roughly. Again, there's no rule book.
Right.
But after 3 or 4 years, you were supposed to move to Los Angeles and audition at the Comedy Store or the Improv, and that would be putting your flag in the ground.
Or take up the show business.
The first piton in
yeah.
the mountain.
Right.
And then you'd... Theoretically, you take out some money. I had $5,000 saved, so with that, you could get a used car and have at least a year's rent somewhere
right.
in an apartment you'd get. We slept on each other's floor. I slept on Jerry's floor for 5-6 weeks. And then Reiser came out and slept on my floor for 5-6 weeks. Now, here's a story you won't run into an awful lot. Reiser, it does not think that bowel movement jokes are really funny. And not surprising, I've never told this, but we're staying at my apartment when he moved out. Yeah, there's no reason not to tell.
Okay, good.
I just went into my bathroom. It's one bathroom.
Sure.
It's a one-bedroom apartment. So there's my bed, and I had a fold-out couch. And he was staying on that. And we were going to Cantor's. I lived right behind Cantor's. And we were going to Cantor's for lunch. That's right, we just called Wolfberg up. To say we were going to go to Cantor's and didn't want to join us, and he wasn't going to join us, so it was going to be me and him. And I had to go to the bathroom, and I did, and it was an immense evacuation.
Sure.
And
it was a good one.
And one immense, like a once every 4 year piece. It was just one thing.
I see.
And I, the reason I'm explaining it this
sure.
way, how's the story going so far, by the way? Pretty well, I think. And
yeah,
I don't know why. I don't know why, because Paul's a little squeamish. And I just, this hasn't happened
you have to
before
see this?
Or since. So I don't know why. I just suddenly, I wrapped my hands in toilet paper. I picked this thing up, which is not easy, and held together. I knocked the seat down and caught it with my other knee and put this thing on top of the toilet. And then unwrapped my hands and washed my hands. And I don't know why. I was just looking at it and then said, all right, and I washed my hands and dried up. You know, you check the mirror for what? I don't know. And then come back out and sat back down on the couch. And Paul said, anyway, we're going to Cantor's? And I said, I'm not much of a con man. I don't play bits on people. I'm not a practical joker. I've never done any of these things before. And I had already picked up, like, a sports magazine and just said, oh, yeah, you hungry? Yeah, we'll go over to Cantor's. All right, well, you want to call Dennis or something? And, okay, and I said, all right, I'll tell you what, go. And I was trying to make this subtle. I said, I'll tell you what, go wash up and we'll go over to Cantor's. Just trying to bury that.
Yeah.
You know, and instead of someone saying, why do I have to wash up now? It's like talking to a child. You know what, go pee and wash up and then we'll go. Why would someone have to say that? But
to an adult.
He bought it. Now, halfway, this is no kidding, halfway down the hallway, he smelled something, so to speak. I don't mean from the bathroom. I mean in what I was saying to him. And he turned around and said, and he knew, he just knew on some level. He said, what's going on there? And I'm back to the magazine. I'm trying to, what are you talking about? What's wrong with you? He said, I don't know, there's something. I said, you want to go eat or not? And I said, come on, just, you know, and checking your watch, things, even if I wasn't wearing a watch, just go, come on, let's wash up so we can get going. It's just all stupid stuff. All right, and he bought it, and he just walked around the corner, and then like,
oh!
You know, 3, 2, 1. Oh! Oh! You sick son of a, oh! You,
and what is the matter with you? Can I ask you a question? What is wrong with you?
And by the way,
yeah.
For whatever it's worth, we're all a little nuts, but I don't mean as comics, all people are. I hadn't done something like that before. I haven't done it since. It hasn't come up again anyway. It's
yeah.
not the kind of thing
it
you
somehow
do once
made
you start,
sense to
like
do.
After you propose marriage to someone. It's not the kind of thing you want to bring into life, you know.
Right.
But that one day, and by the way, the follow-up, the aftermath, the denouement of this.
As there should be to this.
I would have to, he came back out again and said, get rid of that thing. So I had had my laugh, so I wrapped my hands
give me a minute.
Again and pick it up again, lift the thing with my knee again.
Sure.
Still held together.
Uh-huh.
And then put it, you don't want to drop it because it's been such a friend. You don't want to hurt it. So I put it in and
Glenn
washed my hands again, closed the seat, 409 the seat. I don't know whatever I had, and
these are early days.
That was a glowing moment, and yes, from the early days of comedy.
Oh my.
And then, by the way, because we're two guys who I guess 27 or something like that, so we still just went to Cantor's and had a nice meal.
Yeah. Wow, man. Oh man.
And it was a while before, admittedly, before he had a hot dog again, but I think that's a price that's payable.
Yeah. I think you you rose to the occasion, and I also sort of think that there's a chance subconsciously you decided not to try to top it. I don't think it's a coincidence that it hasn't happened since.
Isn't that weird? Are there other things in life? No kidding now. I mean, not that you've done, that anyone's done, where I don't like practical jokes. I don't like when someone comes up and scares me. I don't need things to happen in life. I don't think that's funny when people do these things.
Right.
I'm never a giant fan. I used to love Ken and Camera as a kid, but I'm not the biggest fan of that style of comedy where you're essentially just pranking people and sometimes makes them feel really awkward, you know. I don't do that. I don't really like it. This was one time I don't...
Something came over you.
And I just, you know, I looked at it, just thought about him
Wait
sitting
a
there.
Wait a second.
Look back again. did the hand around the wall, and then just did it. And I'm not even someone who can pull bits like, I can't do it.
Right.
Wallace once, you know Wallace, you know George Wallace, had said to me in the early days of comedy that he said, you know, if you want to fly first class, now Wallace can sell anything. We used to call him the host of life.
Yeah.
He's just full of light, he's glowing, he's such a friendly,
huge
effervescent, huge presence in life. So from 50 feet away, he can say, how are you, young man? You know, and he can do anything. And he said to me once, if you want to fly first class, he said, what he used to do was, he said, put a $50 bill in the folder of the plane ticket. And you walk up to the counter at the gate and just say, listen, I'm already on already. Just wondering if there's any room for first class. And now, that was Wallace, though. I can't do this. But because I'm stupid, I figure, oh, I'll try that. I can't do this. That same 50 feet away, I start sweating and, you know, my eyes start vibrating really fast. I can't do anything. So I tried it once and I feel awful. And I go up and just said, hi, I'm already on, but I'm just wondering if you have anyone in authority, customs people, I just get very nervous for some reason, anything. And I said, just wondering if you have any first class. And this guy immediately looks down and says, are you trying to bribe me?
Of course, that's why you know you can't do it.
And I just,
that's what happens to you.
Blue, green, orange. And I just, I'm so sorry. Wallace told me. I don't know if you know Wallace. I'm so stupid. I never do things. I just don't want to. Once I pulled the thing out of the toilet for riser, but other than that, and I can't do anything.
It's amazing.
At customs, I can't.
I'm the first to yell, there's nothing hidden up my ass. I want it to be very clear when I get to the front.
I can't take it. Yeah. I don't know why, and it gets more nerve-wracking. And we're not running guns. We're not smuggling things in. We're not taking things out. You have any refugees? No. You know, we're coming in. We have a part in something, or you're going to be a comic.
Sure.
Whatever it is. This is no kidding. This is in Canada, going through customs in Canada for a job in Calgary, one of my favorite places, by the way. And the customs guy, I actually get nervous. The guy, you know, you stand on the line there and the next person had cleared, and I walked up and, you know, first of all, the guy said, you know, something to me. He recognized me and said something, but I had walked up before he said, come up. And he said, you know, go over and stand up there, you know, back on the line. And I just melted. I said, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I really am. I know that you're supposed to wait. I'm so sorry. I went back to the line, and he was looking at me like I was out of my mind, and he said, no, I just asked if you were doing stand-up. He had just asked me, are you here to do stand-up or acting or something? But I heard, because I'm out of my mind, I heard someone look up and angrily say,
stand back.
Stand up on that line. And he maybe didn't even use the word stand up.
Right.
That's how loony I am.
Right.
If I'm bringing an extra apple and you walk past the thing that says, don't bring an apple, I'll open bags and say, and throw out the apple. It's an apple because I like apples in the morning. No, I'll get them there. I'll get Canadian apples, I swear. Out of my mind.
Jamie, you were once asked coming across the Canadian border if you had any sausage.
Sausage, yes.
What?
I specifically saw, and they were very serious about it.
Yeah.
And because I started to giggle, and I'm like, sausage? Like, why specifically sausage? And they're like, people enjoy our sausage here in Canada. It's very, you know, it's not uncommon that people try to smuggle sausage.
It's something I will never forget.
Have livestock.
Yeah, of course.
Bully.
You had Bully with you.
I had Bully.
By the way, she's not kidding, because I had a sausage moment, too, at the border. Now, how often do you get a chance to say that sentence? But that is amazing. The same thing happened. The first AD on this movie, Phil Chapera, and he's one of these guys, lived 2 hours away from the city in Calgary. And he was out there. He was living like Jeremiah Johnson.
Sure.
He had five kids. He did everything. They grew everything. He, you know, killed all the meat and dressed it and made everything. This guy was Grizzly Adams.
Yeah.
And he was a great guy. And he said to me one day, he was upset because he invited me out for dinner one night for a Sunday dinner. It's a 2-hour drive. You got the rental car there. well, where the heck am I going?
Yeah.
Suddenly you're driving through the Yukon in, in a Cobalt, you know, to try to get a free dinner for 2 hours. So I said, gee, you know what, I think I'm just going to stay in the hotel. So before I left, he gave me homemade sausage. He made some deer sausage or moose. No, it was moose sausage. Some, you know, again, what? Look, I eat meat and I wear leather shoes, but, you know, when it's sort of like on the other side of the line, moose, really, moose. So I called Eileen and told her, I said, look, should I bring the moose sausage back? Phil gave me its all. She said, sure, why not? We'll try some moose sausage. And I had it in the bag, though. And when they said, you know, and I didn't know this was a thing, because otherwise I would have been sweating 50 feet away again. Sure. But I thought, hey, I just finished this job, and I'm feeling looking forward to getting home, and it's all as well. And they said to me, do you have any sausage? And I said, why? I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. And I went back to the whole, suddenly you're drenched. You look like Albert Brooks in Broadcast News. You're just drenched. I'm so yes, I do. I mean, I didn't. The guy made it. I didn't make it. I mean, he made it. Phil makes everything. Phil Chapera, he's like a mountain man. And I just, now you're telling a story they don't need to hear. And I just said, you want it? In fact, you know, you take it. I didn't want it. I called my wife. She said, why not? Bring it. But fine with me. I said, you take it. And he said, we can't accept gifts. I'm so sorry. It wasn't a gift. I'm so sorry. I'm just, I don't even want to, I don't want to be in this movie. I'm sorry. That's funny. So I had another sausage thing just like you.
I also find it that, you guys probably get this too. They don't like when you joke around
at all.
Like if you try to ever be lighthearted or try to, you know, they do not appreciate it. Any of these customs people.
Yeah, it's not
not joke around with them.
It's not even a matter of trying to be a smartass.
No, you're just trying to make it lighthearted.
Yes.
Right.
No, anything, but especially with guys like us.
Mm-hmm. It's their instinct, you know, to try to, you know, be silly or.
Also, though, when we're not trying to, they might think. If we're dead on serious and polite, they sometimes think we just say, no, absolutely, sir, I know exactly what you mean. Just saying that, a guy might say, you making fun of me?
Right. Mm-hmm.
No, I promise you, that was completely sincere. Now you're making fun of me. No, I swear, I promise. No sausage, no apples, I just, I'm doing stand-up, I swear, I'm to job, just want to hear someplace I could lie. You know what? Send me back. I don't even want to come in. I can't take it anymore.
I think the writer on the film is a communist. You're starting to give away people.
That's right. Give up people.
Anything, sir, if I could just get back to my family.
There's a makeup artist I have something to tell you about, I swear. Making things up.
I'm not sure she's praying to the same God we are, sir.
As long as I don't have to testify.
We like to involve the audience on occasion.
Right.
Oh, yes. And
oh, yes. Oh, that walking.
Oh, yes. Walkin'. Oh, yes. It's sing-songy is what it is. It's a musical lyric, really.
I don't do anything like you do, but I can do one word of walking, kind of, like, and only 60% do it, and it's only one word. It's madness.
Nice.
Not bad. Not too bad.
No, it's the essence. It is a cadence, and you hit it. Madness. Yeah.
I can do one sentence. I can do Peter O'Toole as a supermarket checkout clerk.
No, you can't. Not on this show. All right, go ahead.
This is the one thing I can do. Peter O'Toole as a supermarket checkout clerk.
All right. Take a moment.
Hold it. I have to. Uh-huh. Believe me. Why didn't you show me the coupons before?
What just happened?
See,
I need to know the genesis
He's very mad. I don't, because his time was wasted, because he didn't. I don't know, it's one of those things for us, again, I wrote that line, it popped into my head, it sounded like Peter O'Toole, it's like the thing with Ryza, not before or since have I tried to be.
Alan Arkin and his son play a game, one word impersonations, so you came up with the madness for Walken. The word should not be catchphrase of any kind that the person is famous for saying.
Right.
So like the example I remember I offered up when he introduced me to the game was Clinton, and the one word impression was lingerie. Right?
Very good.
So this game, however,
very good. Go ahead.
Is a series of this or that Coke or Pepsi styled rapid fire questions.
Great.
In the form of rapid fire
Coke, by the way.
Five. And we call it a Tweet 5.
T5 forever now.
And that's what Dave Koechner did.
I was going to say, who's funnier than David Koechner?
Oh, my. It's a little unfair.
That guy.
Quite frankly.
I saw him.
He's cheating.
At a wrestling match here at Staples Center. I took one of my kids. And another sentence you might not hear all that often, but I've always been a fan of wrestling. One of my kids loves it. We watch all the pay-per-view stuff.
Sure.
And Koechner was, by the way, it's great. People who don't understand it. There's no time in life, if you think about it, today, where you get to boo. Think about that. Where you really get to, it's not like a baseball game in 1923. When you really get to go, boo, 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 bad guy.
Yeah.
It's great. Or go, yay, yay, there's a good guy. It's like opera for people who go to McDonald's. And I go to McDonald's, you know, and so do you, and so does everyone sometimes. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
So I saw Koechner there. He came over and I said, get a load of us, two pinheads like us. And I said, it's not surprising to me that you're here. And he said, same with you. We've always liked each other. Anyway, forgive me. Go ahead.
No. So this tweet 5 comes from a Twitter follower.
Mm-hmm.
It's like at @DMSJR_writer. Tweet 5. Stand up or acting? No correct answer.
No, that's funny because there's like a thing from the Corolla thing we do. There are no wrong answers to this. You know what? No kidding. I can't be fast on most things in life. To me, stand up is acting and acting is stand up. That's not a hedge.
Right.
It's saying that even from the start, I was a storyteller, I'm doing characters in the stories, right. I put on accents, I do things. It's always been acting to me in the stand-up. I think probably stand-up has a tiny edge because, as you know, we can write, direct, produce, and star in our own shows, and anything you think is rich and funny.
Yeah, I don't think it's a hedge. I think we both share, especially going over your dossier and some of the past interviews you've given, we both have a similar belief, which is we feel absolutely blessed beyond belief that we're allowed to do both, that we're allowed to have this lifelong career of doing what we love. So to choose, it's not a Sophie's choice, of course, but when people ask which I prefer, I often answer, I prefer not to be asked.
Or, you know what, that's actually a perfect answer for you, by the way. Again, another one of those, stop speaking, that's what I prefer. You know what, though?
Yeah.
It's no kidding when someone says the favorite part of the favorite thing, I mean with my full heart, the next one.
Yeah.
Because the chance to work
is
great. What's the best thing you're doing? I'm on stage right now if I'm performing. That's the best thing I've ever done.
Yeah. I don't know, I'm there. It's the in-the-moment aspect also. Okay, voice or live acting? You're doing the voiceovers, you're doing the animation voices.
Animation. I'm sorry, but it's the same thing.
Yeah.
This is so unsatisfying for your game. I love each one. I just did some great voice acting stuff that I love doing for the people who do Madagascar.
Mm.
And I've done it a few times. See, the thing is, because I like them, seriously, I love animators and animation. I love cartoon work, and I still call it cartoon. To me, it's like saying, I like the word reporter. I've never liked the word journalist.
Well, we were at the Hollywood Bowl. Incredible. Oh, my God.
This is something
weird. L.A. Philharmonic will talk about this next for the Looney Tunes.
Good.
And Bugs at the Bowl. Is that what, Bugs at Hollywood Bowl? What was that show called?
It was
Bugs Bunny at the Symphony.
Yeah.
At the Symphony.
Oh, my
God. What a historical moment for me. Mighty Wind or Best in Show?
My God. You know, they're so good. I love... Who doesn't love Christopher Guest?
There's a gun to your head.
And they put such a good group of knuckleheads together. I'll tell you one thing.
Mm.
I'll tell you. That's for someone to say about as a fan of the movie. But the one job on those I've loved best is For Your Consideration. And here's the reason.
Mm.
Because there was one night. You'll know about this kind of thing. It's a great show business story. Because this is the kind of show business that we both love.
Right.
It's not flashy. On the set. 8 or 10 of us, this group of knuckleheads, Eugene Levy, Catherine O'Hara, Willard, who may be the funniest guy in America,
right,
and Bob Balaban, who is so great. And so it's about 8 people sitting around in between stuff, and we started playing a movie word game.
Mm.
And for about an hour, instead of even going to the meal break, we got so into it, and people would improv just being funny off of the answer. I laughed so hard, and we went counterclockwise. everyone was laughing so hard, and we got so close. It was so much fun. The way people can think of, imagine being in this group for that period of time.
Right.
I laughed so hard, and the next day coming to the set, Balaban was driving his rental car. It was like a LeSabre or something, and he's on at base camp there, which is where all the trailers are and makeup. And he drove by. He was just coming in, and he smiled at me, and he rolled down his window, and he said, "Do you think we can do that again tonight?"
Yeah.
And
often it's the fun that's at in play on a job that makes the memory of which film do I like the best. And there's a perfect example.
It's perfect.
Yeah.
And I said to him, and it turns out I was right, and I didn't want to be right, but I said, "You know what? I've been thinking about that all day, and I know I'm going to be thinking about it for years.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I'm talking about it now. I haven't talked about it in a long time." But I said to him, "I think that may be one of those lightning in a bottle things."
Oh, no, it was.
"And that if we try to do it again, it'll feel like a shadow."
Movies or TV?
Well, no question about it. Again, I
you hate this game.
Well, I can't. This is why every time someone calls at home and says we want to do a poll, I say to them, I would give you the 12 minutes, but you can't ask me. I'm the last guy to ask about polls. If you had to pick 60%, I can't. So do you think it should be higher this or lower that? You know what? Sometimes. Is there a sometimes answer? And I mean it with my full heart, though.
Right.
I'm not avoiding it, saying anything. Who hasn't seen the best movies of their lives and been thrilled by them? How many great TV shows, though, are as good or better than any of the middle ground or worst movies?
Yeah.
I mean, if
it seems to me that a lot of the TV dramas now are more compelling than most films that I'm seeing. And maybe because they have a huge advantage where I'm tuning in weekly and getting to know these characters better and getting to care about them more. But the best of the best versus the worst of the worst, I mean, you're stacking these things up.
Here's
a bizarro one for you, though.
Sure.
Frank Caliendo or Rich Little? He wants Pollock to answer as well.
Well,
I'll answer to no one, first of all.
No, I think you misunderstand.
You idiot.
It was a nice question.
He's a moron, this guy. I won't have it in my house.
I won't have it. What's that from?
Anyone who poses that question is a moron.
Well, thank you.
Frank Caliendo, you got like two good impressions, and then everything else is just fat blank.
I think it's important to speak your mind at this point, honey.
You know what, by the
way? Why are you hedging? This is ridiculous.
It's true. It's like, oh, look, fat De Niro.
And Rich Little
Jerry
was a brilliant
Seinfeld.
Technician who wouldn't know funny if you hit him in the face with a comedy shovel. So really, we've got two arguments here as to why.
You know what, by the way, one of the things I always liked about, and seriously, you know, Frank, I've never met, the guy does, you know, great stuff. Plus, I'm always, no kidding, when one of us in our...
Sure.
In this thing. By the way, I always thought we should be able to use a phrase like Cosa Nostra, because it means our thing.
Yeah.
This thing.
Right.
And that's what we're in. So it's sort of like that without the strangling, without needing to make your bones
right.
get in. The bones are you funny at all?
Yeah,
even
yeah.
a little?
Yeah.
But when he got a show, when people succeed.
Love that.
Because as you know, and a lot of people don't in show business, someone's success, I always call it like the four gas stations on the corner story.
Mm.
That I remember when I was a kid and I saw four gas stations go up on the corner of Peninsula Boulevard and Mill Road. I thought, as a kid, they're going to take, you know, no one's going to be able to make a living. But my dad told me, no, actually, you know what? They'll actually do better each because it increases people's attention to gas. And they'll think of that as a gas neighborhood. And that whichever way they're driving, I could always fill up at the corner there, because there's always be, no matter which direction I'm going, there'll be a place I can just pull into.
Right.
So it actually increases. That's how the success of a sitcom or this show, your show, the one I'm, you know, going to do. You know this and I know you know it. The only competition in show business is with yourself.
Yeah.
Is with keeping your head screwed on straight and working.
Yeah.
But so anyway, but what I always used to love about Rich Little as well is that he was, as you say, a technician, and he was from an old school kind of show business.
Mm.
Well, he's a couple of generations before
sure.
us. So that he, you know, the butterfly tie, you know, as soon as you see, you know, that, it's like performers who used to have a song that would go with their act, you know, like when they'd come out, I'm a guy.
I'm a nice guy.
That's right.
I'm a nice guy.
That's right. So I'm afraid that's another can't pick.
It's another fail, sir. That's what we're writing that down as a big F. Tell me, shed a little insight, because I have very brief memories, but you were in the heart of it night after night. We won't dwell too much more in the house of the strip or catch, but those moments when the very young, always original thinker Larry David would get on stage as a young stand-up, how long would it normally take him to disassociate from the audience and feel as though they were encumbering his happiness?
That's a very funny way to put it. By the way, he was the first guy to pass me at an audition, which was a Catch Rising Star. And he was the MC. That was the Monday night things where people would do 5 minutes and they'd have 60 people on or something. And I'll never forget, he was sitting down at the side of the stage, and everyone knew that he was already known as, this is a very smart, thoughtful, interesting, different kind of thinker, writer, comedian.
Right.
David, that is. And I can still see it now. Mm. I can still see his face looking up at me in a very quizzical way, but in a good way, that whatever I was doing, he thought had something in it.
Mm-hmm.
That,
yeah,
diamond in the rough, maybe, or at least a rock in the rough, or at least just the rough.
Sure.
But I mean,
nonetheless,
that,
he saw something.
And I can still see, just glancing down, and maybe at the end or in the middle, I can't remember, but I can still see his face looking up and thinking, well, this is good. That's an interesting guy, and that looks like an interesting look. And then when I got off, he came over and said something. Funny, for people like us, what he actually said, I can't remember. I remember the face.
Right.
And the
tone and the...
Yeah. And then the aftermath was, that I passed. But
yes, that's what
I don't even remember that. What I remember is seeing his face at that moment when I was on the stage. The stage, for people like us, isn't... A more intense kind of life, in a way. We notice more.
Yeah.
In the tumult of all of our lives, in everything we do. Most people would think it's terrifying to be on stage, but for people like us, it's actually the only calm moments we have, really.
Yeah.
When you come through a curtain and it closes behind you, people like us almost want to go, wow, it's good to see you.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't matter the ride down, the job, the negotiation, whatever the thing is, you got it, you didn't get this part, that part, whatever
it is. Let's talk.
Yeah, just, I wrote this stuff and I'd like to show it to you.
Yeah.
It's a great pure moment.
But seeing Larry on stage, Larry David on stage in those early days,
Look, it was the start of, we're all different as performers. And I used to think, because also we were friends and you get to like people.
Sure.
And I almost wanted to say sometimes, watching him just going, no, don't get mad. They're fine, because my way would be to keep building with bricks and keep building a wall.
Right.
But obviously, he's succeeded mightily with wonderful work.
Sure.
In a variety of different ways.
Oh no, of course.
In his way,
that part
which
we
was
know.
To, but I mean, his way on stage, which is to.
The hell's the
get
matter
that,
with you people?
You could see a pause in a person, you'd say, that's it. You could say to people, the same people you know that we all know now, turn to someone and someone would say, yeah, that's it now. And and then you could count down, like, and then he just walked. He was famous, and when they were making Seinfeld famous for that at one of the meetings with, you know, all the network people, they said, you know, something about, well, and then the classic thing of notes, you know, they said something about, well, this or that, maybe this or that, and that most of us, you, me, Jerry, George Shapiro at that point, everybody is prone to at least say, well, that's an interesting thought.
No,
let's think about it. Larry, yeah, and the show wasn't even on yet. And then he just, like that, the same sort of thing, just went, that's not the show we're making. And he didn't say it to slap someone down. It's just that, that's the guy. That's not the show we're making. And George said something. Well, Larry, the listener said, no, that's not the show we're making. We can make, Jerry, and we'll make the thing, and the way the universe works and planets are lined up, that everyone there just more or less teetered and went, okay,
Yeah.
You know, could it have gone the other way? But it didn't.
Yeah, uncomfortable for everyone but him, and yet clarity was instant for these network stooges, who they were dealing with, for better or worse.
For better or worse is a famous line that I've always loved of Jerry's, is entertainment is not their field.
The network.
Yeah, it's not.
Right.
It's not.
I'll tell you what I've found their savant-like ability is, what their genius is, to find the epicenter of what's special or funny about the idea, to find its center where they add water. But that but that ability to find...
No, it's really quite a thing, yeah.
That chi and is uncanny.
It is. And by the way, it is not lip service to say, as we also both know, it's a cliche, but it's show business and there's business in it. You and I can't do that. We need and want partners in the business. Mm. It's very interesting that, you know, it's the only business where people, especially in comedy, where everyone has an opinion. No owner of the football team ever goes to the locker room in halftime and says to the running back, you know what, I think if you turn your shoulder more when you're going around the line, try that. Or bring your knee up more. No one would ever say, here's how you do it. Or to the quarterback, I think maybe you're bringing your arm too far back. Try coming over the top a little more. No one would ever do that. But in comedy, everyone has a thought of, you know what, I think if you picked up the pace a little. Well, the classic Newhart story of before his first TV show, when I don't have to even start to do, I can't do Bob Newhart, you could, but with that wonderful speech pattern, they said, they had a meeting and sat him down and said, you know what, Bob, let's pick up the pace a little and not have a lot of the hemming and hawing there, and let's get to the story. Just tell the story.
Oh, and to the king of hemming and hawing.
Which is, and he
the
said,
man
well,
that built a career on hemming and hawing.
Without the stuttering, there's no comedy. You know, that this is the thing.
You actually found the thing.
Yes. Yeah,
you so, geniuses.
You know what? Take that that thing.
Yeah.
We can lose that.
Larry, could you do the log on the toilet without the log? Because we think that would be funny. Could you just do the toilet seat and then Paul comes around and sees? Let's talk about the book. Throw me up a photo of this wonderful tome that Lawrence has written. We have a photo of the book you guys want to throw up. Well, we can talk about all this right. A little bit.
Well, it's
Spoiled Rotten America.
Not my choice for the title.
Outrages of Everyday Life.
Not my choice for the title. It's, by the way, on this website I have. It's going to be so that it came out. It did very well when it came out, and I have I bought 6,000 remainder copies. Anyone we know that has a book has done this because they burn them,
sure.
You know, or they tear the covers off or whatever the heck they do. It's a publishing thing, so I bought them, and I remember saying, well, it's my book. I wrote a book, you know. So they're in the garage in
sure.
Stacks. On pallets.
Oh, yeah.
And by the way, another word you don't get to use a lot.
No.
They're not stacked. They're on pallets.
Yeah.
They were delivered on pallets.
You have a Costco amount of books.
That's right. Even the people at Costco would say, that's a lot. And so, so I'm selling them on the website, which, by the way, is LarryMillerHumor.com.
LarryMillerHumor.com.
And because there were so many Larry Millers, no kidding, there were so many Larry Millers that...
Sure.
There was a guy who just passed away... And by the way, there's a DVD and these hats with the five levels of drinking on it, you know. But regardless, though, I used to feel, it's relatively recent for this, I used to feel cheesy just selling stuff. But you know what? Then it hit me very shortly in. Even the Kennedy Center sells T-shirts.
Yeah, don't be an idiot.
And they're not doing it to further culture in the country.
No, they're not.
You know, that someone we both know was with the Rolling Stones and Jagger took him down to, apparently to see, he said, want to see the money. And he said, well, what do you mean? He said, we've got the money with us. And he took him downstairs to, not Carnegie, whatever the hall was, and they have 100 people at tables making jackets and, you know.
Sure.
And he said, there it is. There's the money.
Yeah.
And by the way, it might have been Terry Thomas. I don't know. I don't know what voice that was. It might have been Henry Higgins. I don't know. I can do
it. It was a slightly hungover Michael Caine.
That's right. Right. I can do one word of Rex Harrison, too. Oh, that's right. I can do one word of Rex Harrison.
Okay.
Delightful. Delightful.
Perfect. Another perfect one-word impression, sir. You have found the word that he's not famous for saying, but summarizes his soul. From the chat room, at New York Actor has a tweet five for you, sir, because we all love how you play this game.
T-5.
Now, this time around, Larry, this time around, we ask that you stop running.
All right.
Stop running for office.
That's exactly
and just
right.
Pick one.
It's like Minnie Pearl wearing a Yankee hat with this price tag on it. I've always been a fan.
Yes.
Really?
Rather kiss Julie Roberts or Renee Zellweger. Go. In a movie, by the way.
Right. Julie Roberts.
Worse. What's worse, being from Long Island or telling people you're from Long Island? Presumptuous.
I love Long Island.
See? He says I'm from there. So that's like...
Okay. I love Long Island. Just to put people... I love both. Sorry.
What's funnier, yada, 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 or that's a shame?
For me, that's a shame would be funnier because I couldn't say yada, yada, yada.
Sure.
I could say that's a shame.
Another what's funnier, Lovitz or Richard... Richard Kind, I'm assuming he meant to write. It says Richard King. Is there a Richard King in your life?
You know what?
King? It's got to be Richard Kind.
That's something Alan King used to say when he was in a lot of his bits.
Right.
Because it was always someone saying to him, like an insurance adjuster, well, Mr. King, that doesn't look too bad.
Yes.
I agree. Now, would you mind taking a look at the side that was hit?
But in this case, it's Richard Kind.
He did mean kind.
He did mean kind.
Okay. You know what?
Thank you.
Thank you. I don't play the game well. I'm sorry. I can't. They're both funny.
And wildly different.
Yeah.
You enjoy being on Letterman or Leno if you had to choose, gun to your head?
You know what? I've been on Letterman the last couple of times because I like doing that show and they put comics. I love doing stand-up on it again, but Jay's an old friend. I'll be on again there. It's, again, the same thing.
There's no bad.
It sounds like
there's
running
no
for
bad.
Exactly. It's like saying, do you want to be in show business in Montana or in Indiana?
Yeah,
or both.
Coke or Pepsi is a good guideline because it's a taste issue.
Exactly.
It's not
and
a
I can
matter
say,
of...
like that, Coke.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it's not
I
like...
need to re-educate. Clearly, the people who were at
no,
Larry,
no.
It's not you. I'm.
No, but by the way, you know what, pal? No kidding. This is, it shows you in a way where we are in our country at this time because people do think they want to know what's the thing or the other thing.
Yeah.
And they don't know that, in my opinion, I think yours too, for people like us, if there's good in it, just find the good. God, that sounds like a sampler, but it's true.
No, it went from being a silly game to War and Peace. And that's really what I was after. I need two things from you, sir.
Yes.
If you would be so kind.
Okay.
Because I have been telling versions of these as your life experiences.
Okay.
Not as my own. Clearly giving credit where it belongs, because that's how we were trained and brought up.
Sure.
It's Mr. Johnson... and the policeman's dinner. Which one would you like to regale first? I said Mr. Johnson because that's how I remembered the teacher's name.
Oh!
Hello, Mr. Johnson.
Oh, I didn't even mean like road stories, yeah.
Remember the time we...
Yeah, that... Only mackerel.
So the policeman's dinner was the widow.
Yeah, no, this is... Everyone knows comedians have stories. This was the Iowa State Police Association convention. And it indicates, you'll see after this story, that I'm in the back. It was an early road job. I still don't even know how they hired me. I'm wearing my little sport jacket. I'm standing next to a trooper in uniform who's one of those Norman Rockwell troopers, by the way, who's just immense.
Right.
And from the front of the chest to the back was like that big.
Sure.
You know, it was like Rulon Gardner, one of those builds, you know, just but all muscle and with this thing across. And he's going to walk me up front. And so we're listening to, they're doing the speeches, which is, you know, whatever it is at a convention.
Right.
It's 1,000 officers and their wives in a big domed ballroom.
Sure.
And the guy says, the couple of awards, and then he says, all right, now, before we bring on our entertainer, last week, as you know, young Danny McPhan was shot and killed in the line of duty. Changed the name, but I mean...
Right.
Now, he says that shot and killed in the line of duty, and I'm in the back of this whole thing now, and I said, whispered to the trooper, and I had to look up, and we're both standing, and I said, what'd he say? And the trooper leans down and says, we're going to have a little memorial service now.
Right before you go on.
And I said, you know, I'm a comic. And he said, shh. Now, they bring on the guy's partner, who breaks down, can't finish his speech, and has to leave. And they bring on no one should know from it. The widow and the children, they're going to give her a foundation check. She, poor thing, faints, and they have to revive her with salts and cart her off, you know, on like a stretcher or a beer thing. You know, you got to know I got the legs. And the children, they unfurled a portrait of the guy the length of the arch next to an American flag they rolled down. Everyone stands and sings a hymn. And then, as if it had been scripted, the guy says, and now, here to make you laugh. And I looked at the trooper, he looked at me. Now here's the thing about us that I really believe and that I really love, especially with comics. It's not the acting part now or the writing part or anything else, or the host part, the thinker part. As comics, it didn't enter my head for even a millionth of a second to not go on.
No.
There are, I think, many actors in theater who would just say, excuse me, the roof just caved in. Mm. We're not going on with this play. And that's their right to do it.
Sure.
Or anything, the same thing with a lecture tour. Look, someone's just been shot. I'm not going, you know, this is not the time for my speech. But for comics, and I'm all alone. I'm in the middle of Iowa, and I'm not that good anyway. I still don't know that. It's sort of about a year in, and I've got a sport jacket on. But the only thing I knew was, of course I'm going on.
Yeah. Even then, you must have had an instinct that this can't be good to follow.
Oh, well, I knew. As I'm walking up, I thought, wow, this is awful. This is, like, very, very bad.
Yeah.
And plus, you feel bad for the family. And it's you feel as bad as the people do. You know, people are weeping.
Yes.
But it wouldn't enter our heads to say, you know what? Like a self-preservation. It's not a need for a stage. It's just saying, you know, and it's not, I must be on stage. So I went up, and it was also one of those sets where they say, we want you to do 7 hours. You
know, yeah.
And they say, okay, for $110, fine. Whatever the job is.
Right.
But it was like a 45-minute set they wanted, which is a long time.
You had 26 minutes max of material.
Yeah, and that's throwing in every remotely droll thought you've ever had. Even light observations. You know, it's funny when the forks are different sizes, am I right? It's just nothing at all. And so I went up, but you know what? They were so nice that 5 minutes, really nothing, you know, which is a long time, as you know.
Oh, yeah.
That's a long time. And then around minute 8 or minute 11, you know, starting to relax. And I was just doing this stuff, and I kept working. You know what? It wound up being a fine set.
But as memories and stories go, it's always been one of my favorites in terms of how bad can the introduction moment be, or how bad can, you know, it's the old, so many comedians have their own versions, but that's always been one of my favorites.
It's like a medal winner. Everyone has the, and they never did find the head, so please welcome, you know.
Or Albert Brooks with the Richie Havens. The audience is chanting while
they're
standing in the wings.
It's a medical thing where they have the shot of the open sore on the screen behind you, which is...
Yeah, and now...
That's right. The inner ear will look like this before our medication. So please welcome.
You were playing. My understanding of this next one: you were playing at a college, and you had been doing a routine in your act about either going back to a high school reunion or going back to a college reunion, and you run into a teacher that you've known for so many years. But in your mind, whenever you see him, you revert back to greeting him the same way, which is
the first. One of the first jokes I ever wrote when we were baby comics was that an observation, you go back to a high school reunion, you still call all the old teachers Mr. That you could be Secretary of State, but there still feels like you'd still, and then I would just look off into the audience and act and just say, hey, Mr. Cooper, remember when we set you on fire? And no, it's not that it's a great line or a great joke, but it's something, it's an early joke.
It's rock solid, sir.
That's what I mean about, by the way, everything is really acting for us.
Sure.
So you're becoming that guy.
So you've been telling that joke for years leading up
I had been, but I hadn't been doing it for a few years because it was a little older. I was working in Philadelphia, and Todd Glass, who's a great comic now,
wonderful,
was driving me out. He was an agent at that point. This was a $75 job that tacked onto the two or three shows Saturday. So it was 3 a.m. in New Jersey, a local high school. Most of people don't know New Jersey is very rural. It's not like Giants Stadium. It's country. It's more like Western Pennsylvania in a way. At any rate, so the local high school had given the kids the school rather than have them drive around and, you know, drink or whatever, which is actually smart. So they made a South Seas theme, you know, and they really did a nice, almost like a Norman Rockwell job of redecorating the school. So I go there, there's going to be one show, and they're giving them all night, they gave them the school. So I'm going to go on about 3:34 in the morning, and he's going to drive me out. So he's making his commission of $7.50 for it.
Mm-hmm.
But again, we're all babies, so he drives me out in a 67 Nova, you know, with no shocks or whatever that he's driving.
Uh-huh.
But it's fine, it's all good, take 2 hours. And I figure I'll open with this joke, because it will create a bond.
That's right.
Because, hey, you know, it's funny, when I went back to my high school reunion, and I think you'll see someday, I figure, in fact, perfect. And I'll bring it back, dust it off, and what a nice observation. I do the line, not only is there not a laugh, but you can feel there's a palpable, not a gasp, but just an anger. I mean, you can feel it like waves off a radiator where you can actually see the air move. I could see and feel the air move and thought, whoa, what's that?
How could they all be indignant from that?
And I limped through a 20-minute set. There was a little response here and then. I was a pretty good comic at that point, but nothing that coheres, nothing which says, you say to yourself, that's a set. So I got off, and I was feeling, whoa, that's a little weird. Turns out, they had a beloved Mr. Chips-type teacher who just died the week before, named Mr. Cooper. And he was killed in a fire. Now, what are the odds of this?
You opened with,
how many,
hi, Mr. Cooper. Remember
when we set you on fire?
How many? Now, here's the thing that always struck me as amazing, please, is that my understanding was that someone came up to you afterwards from the school
more
and said,
than,
how dare you, how could you? And my notion, and my thought always was, did they really think that you made that choice?
That's the point.
How could they not assume it was a historic coincidence, but rather go right to the assumption was, you're Satan. You chose to open a show by making...
And they didn't exactly think that it was just 10 double sixes in a row. That a kind of shattering odds. You know, 10 Powerball lotteries in a row.
That you were the meanest piece of...
And they came with the... In fact, the president of the class and the homecoming queen or something came right up to Todd, by the way, and said, you can tell your friend we didn't appreciate the jokes about Mr. Cooper. And Todd said to them almost exactly what you said of, you don't think... This guy came out a week ago and researched your area
to find
the one thing that...
And his name was Cooper, you say? This fellow who went in the fire was Cooper.
Because if it's not, you're fired.
I'm not going to go out and say Mr. Smith.
That's right, because it's got to be Cooper. I want to know what hurts them the most. And he said, you don't think that that's what happened? And they said, more or less, yeah, well... So... And then he tells me this after I get off... And it's like, what do they say, not gallows humor, but I couldn't stop giggling. I started to laugh.
Oh, yeah.
But it was like a relief, not laughing at that.
Right.
It was, oh, okay, and another night in show business that we were never scared of. And he said, someone else came up, like one of the, from the Parents Association, said, first of all, it's not funny, and you two better leave. And
you two better leave.
And so I can't stop, and I'm laughing more now as we're going down the knoll back to his Nova. And there are people starting to follow. Now it's like a Frankenstein movie where the villagers have torches. There's, come on! And I can't stop laughing. And Todd, you know, the...
Get in the car!
Get in the car, and I'm in the car, and I just can't stop. And it's a weird laugh, but, you know, I was crying laughing.
Sure.
And just, one of those laughs. So another great moment in the history of the universe.
Right.
Where Todd, because it's such an old car.
Sure.
And the windshield wipers just have metal and there's no rubber. And then fighting, and then I'm... And then finally, throaty rumble, and he just puts it into gear, and by flooring it, you're still 2 miles an hour. It's like an ox cart. And so we left, got out. But again, I think of that very warmly because...
You fled the villagers.
You know what? Another night in show business. That's why I tell anyone who's new in show business, when people come up and say, what's it like, or what's this like, or say, has this just happened to me, or ask for advice? And I always say, with full sincerity, I can tell you what happened to you, okay? Because the good part of the journey you're on is that nothing you do is any different from everything I'm doing now or have done, and the same with you and anyone else.
Right.
You're starting out, he's here, he's here, he's whatever it is. It's all the same. As you said, everyone has had stories. But I think I've been told those two are...
I'm telling you. I've been telling
ribbon
them.
Winners, if not medal winners. And
I've been telling forever. And every now and then I like to check in to make sure that my version hasn't become its own apocryphal...
But it does. That's okay when it does.
That's what happens.
That's
the
beauty
the story.
Of storytelling.
Yeah.
Because it does. You put your own personality
right.
in on it.
Right.
You have stories that someone else could tell. You made me laugh so hard on Jimmy Edwards' bit when we worked together years ago
right.
of the baseball announcers filling time.
Sure.
You had me on the sidewalk in San Diego
right.
slapping the sidewalk,
yes.
holding onto buildings for about 3 hours one day. And then when I finally heard, pardon me, Jimmy do it, who's a friend of both of ours,
right.
and I love the guy, but I almost wanted to say, oh, but I was laughing at Kevin's thing. He had other things he put into it.
Right.
As you said, here's Jimmy's bit, and then doing it.
Yeah.
So, sure, we put our own brand on every story we tell.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. This particular story, how about an hour 40?
This is, as you know...
This is what we do.
There's nothing better than this. This is why people watch it. This is why people like it, because this is real... I love the word entertainment. It's such an honorable word to me. I disagreed so much in Gladiator, the movie, when Oliver Reed, such a great actor who passed away shortly after that, you know, says to Russell Crowe's character near the end, I'm not going to join your rebellion here, so you are here, he says, whereas I am just an entertainer.
Right.
And he says it, and it's great acting, and I know the moment the writer and the director and the actor were going for, but even when I first saw it, I said, that's wrong. There's nothing deeper than being an entertainer.
Mm.
Entertainment is the greatest thing in the world. It's not having a serious expression at a school board meeting where everyone's an idiot anyway. I'm
right.
sorry to paint with that broad a stroke, but you know, where nothing will ever change, nothing will ever be made better. We all have serious expressions. Or in the Senate, or in any of these places, all these hatchet faces, they've missed the point.
Right.
They're the one. I think people, like folks watching, like you and me, to go an hour 40 course, why not? We're not going to go 3 hours, but we could. Someone could write in.
Yes.
And what better is there
yeah.
to use this great technique and technology and to bring it a new kind of storytelling to
well,
people?
Well, I want the second half of the 3 hours, so you have to come back because you're on the road again. You're touring, and people the same LarryMillerHumor.com is where
That's
they'll
right.
find the tour dates.
That's right.
Where they can get themselves a copy of the book and the DVD, Larry Miller Live.
And the hat and stuff.
And the hat and all kinds of stuff. And the Huffington Post you're writing for and the Standard.
I did one for the Huffington Post about 6 months ago. I like humor. I love to write.
In the form of essays?
But I'm putting all my work, and I write 2 or 3 or more blogs a week.
Right.
So it's like full articles for me. But as we both just agreed, it doesn't pay anything.
Right.
But I love it because I'm growing
right.
this site and a chance to speak to people
well,
like this.
Well, if you're demanding freedom of expression and an opportunity to entertain, you can also, at certain points, experience, this is for the love of it, this is for the commerce, this is for the love of it, this is for the commerce.
But yes, but as you said before, that you knew, and I knew the same thing. Doing Adam's show and doing this podcast, I'll be doing that. We said the same thing. There's not even a second of a thought of, but I'm not getting anything for it.
Right.
We did so many shows anyway for free because you're learning.
I didn't realize until people started asking me, well, what are you getting for that? And then I have to have an answer for that. Okay, well, my answer is when the show, it's appropriate for people to pay for it, they will. Until then, the show needs to find its legs. I need to find out if I'm any good at this, if I even enjoy it, if
yeah.
people want to, yeah. So, you know, it's...
To build a mountain of another way to entertain.
Right.
And that's what you're doing. That's why I knew it instantly. We're friends anyway, but I mean, that to come on, hey, you want to come on the show? Of course.
Yeah.
I didn't know it was this great, seriously, with the team you've built. And I'm going to build one.
You
now
started
too.
The 23rd, you said?
Yeah, it's a podcast, initially just a voice coming on down on iTunes. But I love doing Adam's show.
Right.
He's doing it live. It's the same thing now. He has a couple of sponsors.
Right.
But you know, when I was doing it, he told me once when I first did his radio show, because you don't make money for it. I just used to love to riff with him,
right.
And I still do. It's like jazz.
Yeah.
It's like all the jazz players in the 20s and 30s, after their shows, would meet at some place and play for another 5 hours.
Yeah.
Because they're jazz musicians.
That's what we do.
So right. When I would come down in the morning to do Adam's show, he used to say, yeah, it's funny, other friends don't want to come by, or they're not plugging something, and I... Not because, well, I just didn't understand it then, and I don't understand it now.
Right.
I knew I dug working with him, and I dug the riff.
Right.
And same now, but so the same, look, hopefully, God willing, another 10, 20, 50 years, we ought to be able, in our business, it's not like being a football player, we ought to be able to riff until the day we don't breathe anymore.
Yeah.
And if we get injured or something, well, we can riff in writing.
Right.
So, no, man, hour 40, you know what, I'm going to go home after this and be with everyone. Tonight I'm doing a benefit. All I know is, what's my favorite thing I've ever done in show business? My favorite part, my favorite show, my favorite theater, my favorite anything? Right now,
yeah.
With you.
The one
because we're here now.
Yeah.
And this was good.
I can't thank you enough. You must come back. The name of is the Late Night Liars?
I don't know if that'll be picked up. It's on the Game Show Network.
Right.
It was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It's with the Henson Company.
If it comes back, will you come back so we can talk about that as well?
Sure.
Okay, please.
I dig it.
LarryMillerHumor.com. As I explained to you before the show, you have one final task before we send you off to your family and then this charity show you're doing. That's your camera. It's
yeah.
Called the Larry King Game. And it is, in fact, your turn to play. So take a couple of moments, gather your thoughts, and when you're ready, at your own pace, bad Larry King impression, that moment when Larry shares something we don't want him to, and then to go to the phones.
By the way, for whatever it's worth,
yes, sir.
Kevin told me about this before the show,
mm-hmm.
But, pardon me, I didn't write anything or think of anything.
No, you
because
didn't.
Because part of the fun,
oh yes,
and I hate to end on something that may or may not be that good, but part of the fun is saying, no, you jump right in. I didn't say, all right, hang on a second. Wait, hold the show up. I just want to go off into a room and
you're
think
asking
of
me to do a bit, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Like, give me 2 minutes and make it a good bit.
Yeah.
But no, I knew there was something that. So now I
swing it.
I can do. Okay, so it's Larry King, bad impression that I can guarantee, and with a city, and then with a thing that just happened. All right,
Larry shares. All
right, back to the phones, King of Prussia, Pennsylvania. Let me first just mention, these are not suspenders, that's my skin. Is it close enough?
That's beautiful.
Close enough for
that's
jazz?
That's beautiful. Larry Miller, thank you so much. Sit there uncomfortably while I sign off to the rest of the folks, but honestly, from the heart, I can't wait for you to come back so we can continue, my friend.
You know how I feel.
An absolute joy, as always. All right, we're going to be next Sunday, of course. Rich Eisen will be a pre-taped as Jamie and I will be in the Pennsylvania for a lovely wedding. But we've got a great show that we did with Rich Eisen from the NFL Network. You'll enjoy that on the 8th and the following week on the 15th. Neil Patrick Harris and many other shows. Go to the site, check the calendar there, and you'll find out what's going on. The chat show itself is now available for pre-ordering on Amazon.com should you feel the need to actually own your very own DVD copy of any of the 75 going on 80 chats that we've had, so feel free to go there. I wonder what the crew has been up to for the last hour 48 while we've been in here having so much damn fun. Let's take, what? Somebody's getting a manicure. Seems odd. It seems like there's a lot of work to be done, but no, that's what the crew does when we're... Wait, what the hell's the matter with you?
How could you?
Wait, it's a fight!
A bigger pillow. Oh no, she's hurt now. Uh-oh.
I see.
Wow.
Left the scene of the crime, forgetting for a moment. Oh, nice
sure.
Touch. Adding insult to injury.
So
I may have hurt her, but I'm going to take her bare. All right, well, God bless each and every one of you, and...
I have to...
Yes, please,
for
please,
10 seconds.
One last.
I have to tell you this.
Okay.
It's not because we're friends, it's true. He has a movie opening, Middlemen, and George Gallo is a friend of mine. I've worked for him before.
Oh, yes.
It's really good. I saw a screening of it. It's terrific.
Yeah.
And as good an actor as he's been in so many things, he's great in this, and we talked about it already a tiny bit. It's a slice he's never done before. It's very, very good. It's a great movie. If you see it, you won't be sorry. I just had to say that.
No, thank you for that, because I meant to get to the middleman, and very sweet, and you're not wrong. The ThisWeekend.com network continues. I'll be on later today, should you be watching us live, around 6:30 with This Week in Comedy with Ed Krasnick, followed by This Week in Movies. And don't forget to check out any and all of the ThisWeekend.com programs. Until next time, I will say thanks to the crew, and everyone here has done another great job keeping us afloat. And so until next show, and as always, get out of my face.